If you're like me, you probably spent a lot of years thinking about the next event we'll be talking about, and maybe have reached a pretty well-defined point of view. But be prepared. Tonight, we're going to get a brand new look at one of the most fascinating mysteries of modern Greek history. Tonight, join me as we answer the question, who killed Kapodistrias, with my special guest, Esmeralda Mourikis. That's all next on a special edition of Musical Masterworks. Musical Masterworks, a program dedicated to the rediscovery of great symphonic, instrumental, choral, operatic, cinematic, and electronic compositions from antiquity to the present, with your host, Mike Stratis. And good evening, this is Mike Stratis, and as you heard, tonight is a tough topic. A lot of us may have been sure about it when we first saw the topic, the assassination of the governor, the first governor of Greece, the great and late Ioannis Kapodistrias, a big name in the annals of Greek history. And be prepared. Tonight, you're going to be blown away. We're going to be testing that theory about who killed Ioannis Kapodistrias, because a lot of research has taken place in the last few years, and you'll be surprised at how much really has not been spoken about or uncovered in the past until recently. And here to help me with exploring this amazing topic is the person who actually proposed this to me. And boy, I have to tell you, I am really thankful that she did. And she's become a pretty regular guest here on my show. I would be tempted to say a co-host for tonight. And I'm talking about Esmeralda Mourikis. Esmeralda, thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you for inviting me, Michael. And it's always an honor and a pleasure to be in your show.
My pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
So you're going to help me out with this one tonight. This is a tough one.
It is.
The assassination of Kapodistrias. So talk to me. What's the story behind this event?
This is the assassination which, with no doubt, changed the course of Greek history. With one fell swoop, the stage was cleared of its protagonists. One of the greatest politicians and diplomats ever lived, Ioannis Kapodistrias, and a highly respected and powerful Greek family who had sacrificed 49 members for the nation's freedom, Mavromichalis. And this assassination took place so that Greece would not be a free nation. The great powers wanted to have control over Greece. And in this context, I would like to mention what Petrobes Mavromichalis said 9 years after the assassination in 1840. Makrianis and the doctor and philosopher Dionysios Spiros were having a political conversation. And Spiros started talking against Kapodistrias. He didn't like him. So Petrobes Mavromichalis interrupted him and said, "You don't judge things right, philosopher. Damn the foreigners who were to blame for losing my boys and losing a politician the nation will never, ever find again. Damn
That's
them."
That's a strong statement, very strong statement. Just for those listening, Petrobes Mavromichalis is the patriarch of this family from the Mani region, the most important, probably the most important revolutionary leader, in addition to Kolokotronis and Papaflessas, a very important man who is speaking.
Well, in the past, historians had given us highly important information about the truth. Among them was Dionysios Kokkinos about 90 years ago. But the biggest research ever done was the one by Dimitris Kokkinakis. He was a brigadier general of the Air Force and a great political analyst, historian, and writer. And he was collecting evidence for more than 40 years. And he put together a huge research with two tomes.
Two volumes, right?
Yeah. And he was from Mani, but he was not related to the family. And I'm really grateful to a very fine researcher who told me about this book. She resides in Europe, and she's not a historian. She's an architect, and her name is Mrs. Lydia Griva.
Let me just step in and say, let's get the names of the works for those who are interested. And I know these are very hard books to find.
The two-volume work is called, in Greek, if I'm not mistaken, P. Dolophonis and Kapodistria, who assassinated Kapodistria. And I think it was reduced into a smaller book, Athoi Tou Aimatos Toutou, which is translated as those who are innocent of this blood.
That is correct.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. And also, I think we've spoken in the past. Are you not a member of the Mavromichalis family yourself?
Yes, I am, from my mother's maternal side. And every single information I have from my mother's documents is more than accurate. Also, let me tell you, I remember my mother telling me a story that her aunt, Sofia Mavromichali, never married in order not to lose the name.
Oh, that's amazing.
And when she reached a very old age, people started calling her Kiria Mavromichali instead of the Spinis Mavromichali, Mrs. instead of Miss, and she used to get angry. And she was correcting everybody, the Spinis Mavromichali, and raising her.
After that investment, I think she had a right
index finger, yes.
All right, very well then. So let's talk a little bit about this amazing personality, this great Greek leader, Kapodistrias, and his achievements. What can you tell us?
Kapodistrias is the one who wrote Switzerland's constitution, to start with. And this constitution is based on the principles of direct Greek democracy. So what he did is he brought back to modern Europe something that pre-existed in ancient Greece.
Right.
And he was given the Swiss citizenship post-mortem. And actually, Lavrov unveiled his bust in Lausanne about 2 years ago, if I'm not wrong. He also saved France from partition and bankruptcy in 1815.
This in light of the Napoleonic defeat at Waterloo, yes.
By influencing the Tsar, Alexander I, against Metternich's plans.
Right.
And Richelieu was so grateful to Kapodistrias that he sent very, very many books to Corfu, to the library.
Those of you listening, Richelieu, of course, is not the great Cardinal Richelieu. This is the Ambassador Richelieu, the famous diplomat and politician of that time period. Continue, please.
The French later, unfortunately, forgot it. And when he was in Paris in 1826, among others, for his liver disease, he had to see his doctor. The French were following his every step. Let's mention also that he was a foreign minister of Russia under Alexander I between 1816 and 1822, but he never gave up his Greek citizenship. Later, though, Alexander was unfortunately influenced by Metternich, who was playing a double game.
That's right.
And he went to Vienna, if I'm not mistaken, in 1822,
right.
Alexander.
Right.
So Kapodistrias goes then to Switzerland, and he resides in Geneva in a very modest two-room home.
So he's in some form of self-exile.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. 3 years later, in 1825, he attends in Bern the Tsar's memorial service, and the next Tsar, Nicholas I, gives him as alimony 60,000 francs, but he did not accept it. As for his relationship with England, this was really bad. He accused the British general who occupied Corfu in 1814 for being a dictator. And later in London, he told Lord Bathurst that the English want the Greeks to forget even the name of their country.
Wow, that's a very...
But it will not work.
Wow.
He was elected governor of Greece in the spring of 1827. He was in London at the time. And shortly after, King George IV writes a letter to the Russian ambassador. I see you have Kapodistrias here. You know my opinion for him, and it will never change. I loathe him.
Wow.
I do not like revolutionists, and he will find himself involved in a dangerous and uncertain situation.
That's a pretty strong statement coming from the crowned head of Britain. So he has been elected governor of Greece, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And so he goes back in 1828 to Greece, correct?
Yes, he went to Greece on January 11th, 1828. Meanwhile, he had sold all his furniture, and with that money, he loaded five boats with wheat for the starving Greeks. He wanted a strong Greek nation, and he suspended the existing constitution of 1827 based on an axiom of the Roman law. Salus populi, suprema lex esto. In other words, the legislation in force must be suspended for the good sake of the country.
That's a very highbrow position, too.
And they accuse him for that.
Exactly.
But he had no choice because he found chaos in Greece That's after right. 400 years under the Turks.
That's right.
He also wanted to give land to the poor people who had fought for the independence. Kapodistrias and Petrobes Mavromihalis were indeed exchanging letters as back as 1818, and they were always using a code. For instance, the word school meant the military camp. They were even considering having a king, but Greek, from the Palaiologos family.
That is a very big statement there.
Yes.
That is amazing. For those of you who don't know, the Palaiologos family, of course, was the last dynasty of the Eastern Roman Byzantine Empire. Yes.
I think from the Mourikis family. Mavromihalis was also among the first who was asking Kapodistrias to leave Russia and become the governor of Greece. There is also a letter dated August 3rd, 1819, which was sent from Kapodistrias to Petrobes Mavromihalis, asking him to delay the start of the revolution. But Mavromihalis never received it because the man who was bringing the letter, Kyriakos Kamarinos, was murdered.
Wow.
And this letter was found years later in the Russian archives and was published. Also, we should not forget that the English wanted Leopold, the Prince of Saxe-Coburg, to take the Greek throne. He was residing in England. He had close ties with England. His wife was the English Princess Charlotte. So Leopold, before accepting, asked for five guarantees. The three were accepted, but the two most important were not accepted. The one was the amendment of the frontier line, because as we know, less territory was attributed to Greece than That's the right. one mentioned in the protocol of October 3rd, 1829.
That's correct.
And to safeguard the security of the people of Samos and Crete from an eventual future invasion of the Turkish troops. So Leopold rejects the throne in May 1830. And England and France held Kapodistrias responsible for that move.
Hmm.
There was indeed a correspondence between Kapodistrias and Leopold. In a letter, Kapodistrias writes to him, "There are foreigners in Greece who are to blame for intrigues and plots, and that is going to get even worse." He also advises him when he goes to Greece to be very simple and modest, because at a time like that, the Greeks would not be fascinated by an aristocrat. He also suggested that it would be a very wise idea to become Greek Orthodox.
Right.
But even the ambassador Rouen accuses Kapodistrias for Leopold's rejection. But we have a letter from the French Prime Minister Polignac, who writes to Rouen the exact opposite. The imminent death of King George is what made Leopold change his mind, because the changes in England might fulfill his ambition. And he was right, because he got Belgium.
That's right.
By the next king, William IV, right?
Right, yeah. Right.
We should also mention that 6 months after the assassination, Augustinos Kapodistrias'
brother, right,
wanted to bring the embalmed body to Corfu, and the English did not allow this to be done on public expense.
Wow.
And after the assassination, Colletis, Augustinos Kapodistrias, and Kolokotronis do form a government, but Colletis didn't want Kapodistrias there, Augustinos.
Right.
So he forms another government in Corinth, and I think there was a third one in Megara, and that's when the Bavarian get the chance to take the matters into their hands and bring Otto as king. And they even canceled his upcoming wedding with the Tsar Nicholas' daughter and gave him Amalia.
Wow, there's a lot of ambition there.
Of course there is. Yeah. And as for the Philhellenic spirit in Europe, Kapodistrias had so hard worked for, it faded away after the assassination, unfortunately.
It would make sense because a lot of the Philhellenes, among them Goethe and some others, clearly mm-hmm. stated that the killing of the great man really made people reassess their support of the Greek government. I think mm-hmm. you're absolutely right. And what about the Mavro Mihailis family? Let's talk about that.
Yeah, that's what I wanted mm-hmm. to say before we go to the assassination. The Mavro Mihailis family originally are from Thrace, not from Mani.
Wow.
They moved to Mani in around 1340 when the Turks started crossing the Elispondo. And we find them in Venetian documents for the first time officially on April, I think it was 27th of April, 1690. As for the name Mavro Mihailis, it came from an orphan, Mikhail. And an orphan is called Mavro in Mani. So from Mikhail's first name and Mavro, which is the orphan, came the name Mavro Mihailis.
So the orphan Michael.
That is correct.
That's interesting.
Yes. And one of Michael's sons was Yorgakis, who was Petrobe's grandfather.
Oh.
And he's the one who married this incredibly beautiful girl. I do not have information from where she came. She was from Europe someplace. And this is why the immediate family were so good-looking, all of them. For instance, Fotini, who was Petrobe's granddaughter and who was a maid of honor in the palace. All the newspapers in Europe used to write that she resembles Venus.
Wow.
And we should also not forget that when Petrobe's son, Elias, was killed in Evia in 1822, the Turk took his head as a bounty. And when Omerbes saw the head, cried.
Wow.
And he said, "What a pity."
Okay, having said that, let's now go to the assassination and take a look at it up close. Go ahead.
George Mavromichalis, Petrobe's son, and Konstantinos Mavromichalis, Petrobe's brother, get dressed that fateful day to go to church in Afplion. This is September 27th, 1831. Let's mention here something. Konstantinos is married to Papa Flesa's sister,
wow.
Maria Flesa.
That's amazing.
Both men were wearing white. Let's remember that. We'll come back to that. They met the governor in a narrow street, not very far away from the church, about 150 meters or so, and they greeted him with respect, and then they walked towards the church, where they arrived first.
So they see Kapodistrias in an isolated location.
Dark.
Dark. They greet him and they keep walking.
Yes.
That's amazing.
If they wanted to kill him, they would have done it there
mm.
because there were no witnesses. As they arrived in front of the church, George stands on the left side and Konstantinos stands at the right side. George is looking inside the church, but Konstantinos is looking towards the house of the minister Rhodios. So towards the opposite direction from where Kapodistrias was coming.
Probably with his back towards the church. Mm-hmm. Okay, makes sense.
And we have two other people there. We have a beggar on the left side of the outside of the church, and a very thin, tall man wearing a black cape standing on the right side of the church, always outside. Mm-hmm. Kapodistrias arrives. He's escorted by his two guards. The second one, Kozonis, replaced his regular guard.
Right.
Who was ill at that day. And there was also Karayannis, the guard of the Mavromichalis.
So he's a standard guard that they've always known in the family, yes.
So Kapodistrias arrives, and the moment Kapodistrias arrived, Konstantinos, who, as we said, stands on the right side of the church, of the entrance of the church, sees a very strange move, either from Kozonis or from the man in the black cape. And he fires to protect himself because he thought that he's in danger. This is the bullet in the wall of the church.
That's fascinating.
So then he runs, and Kapodistrias, surprised, turns his head towards Constantino to see where he's going, what's happening. And this is the moment that he was shot on point-blank range in the back of his neck.
Wow.
So the moment we have
The distraction of Constantinos firing to protect himself.
And we have Constantinos in the front. Kapodistrias receives a bullet from the back.
From the back.
But Constantinos was in the front. How can he
And interestingly,
shoot?
Constantinos is gone. So you got to get him.
Gone.
He's already out of the scene.
Already out of the
right.
scene. And Karayannis, who is the bodyguard, runs after Constantino and shoots him in the abdomen. Meanwhile, Constantinos does not resist at all and does not fire a bullet. He could have done that if he wanted to. He didn't. And all of a sudden, Momferatos notifies six soldiers, and all of them were accidentally found at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, how did they suddenly arrive suddenly? That's a good point. Yeah,
they were informed from before. Oh. And they all run towards Constantino. They started stabbing him. And Fotomaras, from a window, fires a bullet also. I don't know if the final bullet killed him or he was already dead on the ground. And George runs also to find an open door because he thinks they're going to kill him too. And he finds Valiano's house. And from there, he runs to the French ambassador's residence. He says he didn't do anything. He's innocent. And he asks to be turned in to his government.
The Greek government.
The Greek government,
right.
Yes. And there comes Almeida, the Portuguese Almeida, and arrests him. We have to say here that Almeida is married to Zoe Mavrocordatou. She's the daughter of Mavrocordatos.
Wow.
Who is favored by the English.
Right.
He's imprisoned only for 13 days because they decided to execute him. He tells, shortly before the execution, he tells the priest, "I did not kill the governor." And then he walked bravely and with dignity to the site of the execution on October 10th. And he said in a loud voice, "Brothers, peace and love." And then he's the one who shouted loudly, "Fire."
Mm-hmm.
We have also to mention that they did not allow him to see his father. His father was in his house. He was not in prison. And there was no revolution in money.
Which were some of the things that have been brought up later on during
exactly.
the proceedings to
there
try to prove
no revolution
that the Mavromichale had something, a motive against Kapodistrias. Wow. Well, what about the body? I mean, Kapodistrias' body, what did they take a look at it?
There is a weird thing also here. They did just a post-mortem examination, the autopsy, what we say.
Right.
They should have done necrotomy. Necrotomy is a dissection of a dead body.
Right.
They did not do it. It showed a stabbing with a huge knife, and they said it was George's.
Hmm.
George did not have a knife. The knife was Constantine's knife,
right,
and it was very small.
Huh.
Also, the bullet on the wall does not match the bullet in Kapodistrias' body.
Hmm.
They also said that the stabbing was in the legs, but it was in the groin area. So all the autopsy papers were forged.
Wow.
And so were the testimonies.
Unbelievable.
A lady Nafplion writes in a letter, "They forced me to say that Mavromichalis did it." And this letter, at her request, was opened after her last great-grandchild died.
That was the famous Kyria Paraskevoula.
Kyria Paraskevoula, yes. Also, we have the parish councilman. He does not testify, though he had seen everything. And then nobody searches for the man in the black cape. Nobody searches for the beggar. Nobody searches for two suspicious people in a carriage wearing fustanella. And a lot of documents disappeared from the legal files.
Unbelievable.
Among them was what a tailor, Terzis, had said. He said that Mavromichalis is innocent. And there is another one, Ioannis Sarandou. He says that he saw a man in a black cape. And as I mentioned before, the Mavromichalis, both of them were wearing white.
That's right.
And there were also two Europeans there, one from Scotland, one from Wales, and they were keeping a diary. It also disappeared mysteriously.
Hmm.
And as for the archives in England, the file Kapodistrias was never opened because, according to the English, it is part of the English history. Hmm. And I wonder, how can the assassination of a Greek governor be a part of the English history?
Hmm.
Especially if a Greek family was also accused for that.
Right,
so we have two Greek people. Right. Why is it English history?
It's amazing. It's astonishing is a
word. It is astonishing.
Yeah.
And let's also remember what the Russian ambassador said, Robespierre. He was at the assembly with Canning and Guillemot in Greece.
Lord Canning and...
I think that's when Lord Canning passed away,
yes,
during the assembly,
death,
if I'm not mistaken. He said that beyond any doubt, the English planned and executed the murder of Kapodistrias.
Is that the famous phrase in Greek? Ουδεμία αμφιβολία διατηρώ ότι η δολοφονική χείρ εξοπλίστη παρά της Αγγλίας. Is that the phrase?
That is the phrase.
That's the exact phrase.
And of course, we know very well that the English were influencing Greece against Kapodistrias, especially the people in Hydra, and there was the famous organization Hercules there.
Mm.
And they tried to poison Kapodistrias before. There was somebody who gave his assistant Nicoletos money to poison his coffee.
Right.
But it didn't work.
Right, right. Wow, this is amazing. I consider this mind-boggling. I think we're going to need a little time to sit back and reflect on this. All right, what better opportunity than to move on with the news from Greece, and we'll be back with more on Who Killed Kapodistrias. And welcome back to Musical Masterworks. We have an apocalyptic night. A lot of information's coming out. This is, of course, the program titled Who Killed Kapodistrias? And I am here, of course, with my guest co-host for the night, Esmeralda Mourikis, and we are looking at the continuation of the story. And we have the great fortune to have with us on the other line from Greece direct two very special guests who will be joining this conversation. And I speak of Apostolia Kokkinaki, the widow of the late Dimitris Kokkinakis, the great researcher and analyst of this topic, as well as Professor P.Grigorakou, who has played a great role in presenting a lot of this information that has been published. So let's now shift over into Greek. Γεια σας, πώς είστε? Καλησπέρα.
Καλησπέρα σας. Πολύ καλά. Από την Ελλάδα σας στέλνουμε πολλούς θερμούς χαιρετισμούς.
Πολύ ωραία, σας ευχαριστούμε. Θα αρχίσουμε με την κυρία Κοκκινάκη.
Καλησπέρα σας.
Καλησπέρα, κύριε Κοκκινάκη.
Να είσαστε καλά. Τους χαιρετισμούς μας και την αγάπη μας από την όμορφη Ελλάδα μας.
Χαρά μας. Από ό,τι ξέρουμε, ο σύζυγος ήταν άρρωστος όταν τελείωνε αυτό το βιβλίο.
Ναι, ή το άρρωστος. Πάλεψε πάρα πολύ, ξεκίνησε από μαθητής, δεν εδέχεται σε μια ομιλία που είχε γίνει στο σχολείο ότι οι μανιάτες σκοτώσαν τον Καποδίστρια. Του είχε γίνει έμονη ιδέα. Εργάστηκε 40 χρόνια για αυτό το βιβλίο. Ξενύχτηκε πάρα πολλά.
Ναι.
Πάρα πολλές αποδείξεις, όχι ενδείξεις, πάρα πολλές αποδείξεις που αποδεικνύουν ότι δεν τον σκότωσαν οι Μαυρομιχαλαίοι τον Καποδίστρια.
Ναι.
Και μάλιστα αυτές οι αποδείξεις στη σημερινή εποχή μπορούσε να γίνει και αναψηλάφιση της δίκης. Ναι. Δεν θέλησε κανείς να το κάνει.
Πολύ εντυπωσιακό αυτό. Είναι αλήθεια, πως από μικρό παιδί είχε δει τη σφαίρα που ήταν έξω από την εκκλησία και αυτό τον δημιούργησε πρόβλημα.
Βεβαίως, τον άφπλιο, βεβαίως. Ναι. Βεβαίως, και η αποδεικτικά στοιχεία το είχε αναφέρει και μετά το θάνατό του. Είχε αφήσει ορισμένα στοιχεία για την κυρία Παρασκευούλα, τη μάρτυρα.
Ναι.
Αγωνίστηκε πάρα πολύ. Οι Άγγλοι δεν θέλουν να δώσουν στοιχεία για το βιβλίο που έγραφε ο σύζυγος. Αποφεύγανε. Λέγανε ότι είναι απόρριτα έγγραφα και δεν μπορεί να τα δώσει η Αγγλία.
Σωστά.
Δεν ήταν δικά τους, ήταν δικά μας.
Σωστά.
Γιατί δεν τα δίνουνε. Καταλαβαίνετε ότι πάλεψε 40 χρόνια για να βρει αυτές τις αποδείξεις.
Θα υπάρχουν σίγουρα.
Ήταν ένας αγώνας ζωής για τον ίδιο.
Ίσως υπάρχουν και ένοχα στοιχεία. Γι' αυτό.
Ασφαλώς. Ναι. Ασφαλώς.
Και
ασφαλώς.
Ο φάκελος Κύπρο και ο φάκελος Καποδίστρια.
Όπως το είπατε. Ναι. Ακριβώς έτσι.
Τι να πούμε. Το δράμα συνεχίζει. Πώς αντιμετώπισε τα προβλήματα? Ξέρω πως μερικοί εκφράστηκαν με αντίθετες γνώμες για την έρευνα που έκανε. Μεγάλα ονόματα.
Πάρα πολύ.
Ναι. Και πώς τους απάντησε?
Τους απάντησε με τα στοιχεία. Επάλεψε πάρα πολύ για αυτό το βιβλίο. Δεν κοιμόταν τις νύχτες. Κοιμόταν 4, βαριά 5 ώρες ήταν ο ύπνος του τα ξημερώματα. Και όλη η νύχτα δούλευε.
Και πώς κατάφερε να το τυπώσει το βιβλίο?
Έγινε η πρώτη έκδοση, μετά έγινε η δεύτερη και μετά η τρίτη.
Ωραία.
Να πω το καλύτερο, δεν επήρε ούτε μία δραχμή από το βιβλίο.
Σπουδαίο πράγμα αυτό.
Πολύ τον ωραία. Ενδιέφερε να μαθευτεί η αλήθεια, να διαβαστεί από τον κόσμο. Και είχε βγάλει και μία περίληψη του βιβλίου για αυτούς που δεν μπορούσαν, επειδή ήταν δίτομο,
ναι,
να διαβάσουν την περίληψη του βιβλίου. Σας λέω για αγώνα ζωής.
Ναι.
Αυτό το βιβλίο είναι αγώνας ζωής.
Σωστά. Βρίσκεται εύκολα το βιβλίο σήμερα, αν πηγαίναμε σε ένα...
Όχι, δεν υπάρχει τώρα.
Δεν υπάρχει, δυστυχώς.
Όχι, όχι. Έγινε η τρίτη έκδοση και τελείωσε.
Πω. Μεγάλο θέμα.
Σας έχει στείλει, κυρία Γρηγοράκου, ένα βιβλίο της περιλήψεως για να το δείτε.
Ωραία. Πολύ ωραία. Σας ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ.
Να είσαστε καλά και εγώ σας ευχαριστώ.
Καλό βράδυ, καλή νύχτα. Να είστε καλά. Την κυρία Γρηγοράκου τώρα θα μιλήσουμε.
Ναι, ναι. Για να πάρω το σύφτα από την κυρία Κοκκινάκη. Όντως, το Foreign Office επανειλημμένος είχε... ζητηθεί από το Foreign Office και από την καθηγήτρια την κυρία Έλενα Κούκου, η οποία ήταν επίσημη θεσμική καθηγήτρια στο Ελληνικό Πανεπιστήμιο και είχε πάει επανειλημμένο στο Foreign Office, δεν δέχτηκαν ποτέ να ανοίξουν το φάκελο, ενώ κανονικά, όπως ξέρετε, κάθε 30 χρόνια ανοίγουν οι φάκελοι.
Σωστά.
Δεν το δέχτηκαν ποτέ, με την εξήγηση που έδωσαν και που είναι και το επιστέγασμα της όλης ιστορίας και του βιβλίου του Κοκκινάκη, ότι αν ανοιχτεί ο φάκελος, διακινδυνεύουν να διαταραχθούν οι σχέσεις των δύο χωρών. Εάν αυτό δεν είναι αποδεικτικό στοιχείο, τότε ποιο είναι? Και ο Κοκκινάκης σε όλες τις παρουσιάσεις των βιβλίων που έκανε, αλλά και με επίσημα έγγραφα, είχε ζητήσει να γίνει αναψηλάφιση της δίκης. Ούτε και αυτή κατέστη εφικτή.
Ναι.
Να πούμε ότι... βασίστηκε πάρα πολύ στο γεγονός, και μάλλον αυτό του έδωσε και μια περισσότερη όθηση, στο γεγονός ότι ο επίσημος ιστορικός, ο Διονύσιος Κόκκινος, είχε αποδείξει ότι το ιατρικό ανακοινωθέν ήταν πλαστό.
Ναι. Ναι.
Και από εκεί ξεκίνησε να είναι σίγουρος ότι θα βρει πράγματα. Και όπως είχε και την παιδεία του ανακριτή, έκανε την, όλη του την δουλειά πραγματικά σαν ανακριτής. Έπιασε μία-μία λεπτομέρεια. Τις έκανε, τις διασταύρωσε τις λεπτομέρειες, έβλεπε πού δεν είχε δοθεί η απαιτούμενη προσοχή, πού είχε αποσιωπηθεί το τάδε ή το τάδε στοιχείο και έτσι προχώρησε σε ένα σημείο που πραγματικά μας δίνει όλες τις αποδείξεις. Δεν αποδεικνύει ποιος, μάλλον δεν ζητάει στο βιβλίο ποιος σκότωσε, απλώς αποδεικνύει, μάλλον δίνει απαντήσεις αδιάσυστες για το τι και πώς έγινε και ποιοι το οργάνωσαν και γιατί το έκαναν.
Σωστά.
Έτσι το πόρισμα βγαίνει από μόνο του.
Και αυτή είναι, αυτή είναι μεγάλη έλλειψη από ό,τι ξέρουμε στα γραπτά, αφού δεν έγινε νεκροτομία. Ξέρουμε πως οι μαχαιριές, η σφαίρα...
Όχι μόνο δεν έγινε νεκροτομία, αλλά...
Και αλλάξαν τα χαρτιά. Ναι.
Λέει το χαρτί ότι ευλήθη εκ των όπισεν εξ επαφής. Αλλά λέει ότι τον μαχαίρωσε από εμπρός ο Γεώργιος με ένα μαχαιράκι που όμως δεν το είχε αυτός, αλλά το είχε ο Κωνσταντίνος, τον οποίο σκότωσαν επί τόπου γρήγορα-γρήγορα για να μην μιλήσει.
Σωστά.
Είναι πολλά τα ερωτηματικά από εκεί. Λοιπόν, ξεκίνησε να τα ψάχνει ένα-ένα και έτσι αποκαλύφθηκε ότι πραγματικά είναι πολλά τα οποία μας αποκρύπτουν και οι επίσημοι και οι σύγχρονοι ιστορικοί. Να πούμε ότι δυστυχώς τον παρουσιάζουν ως τύρανο εδώ, γιατί προσπάθησε να οργανώσει ένα κράτος που δεν υπήρχε και αυτό δεν βόλευε πάρα πολύ κόσμο, αλλά στην Ελλάδα συχνά διαστρεβλώνουμε την ιστορία κατόπιν εντολών που έρχονται έξω.
Ναι, το ξέρουμε, αυτό γίνεται συχνά.
Το θέμα είναι ότι βέβαια εκείνος ήθελε να κάνει το σύνταγμα μιας ελεύθερης χώρας και αυτό δεν εξυπηρετούσε σκοπούς και συμφέροντα το από το εξωτερικό.
Ναι,
κάτι άλλο το οποίο ίσως να μην το ξέρετε, γιατί ελάχιστοι το ξέρουν και νομίζω ότι μόνο ο κύριος Κοκκινάκης το είχε βρει, ανακάλυψε και αποκωδικοποίησε τη μυστική αλληλογραφία του Πετρόμπεϊ με τον Καποδίστρια μέσω της ρωσικής πρεσβείας της Κωνσταντινούπολης. Σε αυτή την αποκαλυπτική αλληλογραφία υπήρχε υπήρχαν στοιχεία για το ρόλο του Πατριάρχη Γρηγορίου του Πέμπτου, ο οποίος είχε συμφωνήσει με τον Πετρόμπεϊ να ανεβάσουν στο θρόνο της Ελλάδας απόγονο των Παλαιολόγων από την οικογένεια των Μούρτζινων.
Ναι.
Αυτό ήταν που τους έκανε έξω φρενών, διότι ήθελαν να έχουν την πλήρη εξουσία της Ελλάδος.
Σωστά.
Και έτσι θεώρησαν ότι με κάποια κίνηση που καλώς οργανώθηκε θα έβγαζαν από τη μέση και τους Μαυρομιχαλαίους και τον Καποδίστρια. Διότι έτσι κατόρθωσαν στη συνέχεια και να ακυρώσουν το γάμο του Όθωνα με την κόρη του Τσάρου Νικολάου, βρίσκοντας την αμαλία, και να βγάλουν από τη μέση και τους δύο ανθρώπους που τους έμπαιναν εμπόδιο. Βλέπουμε λοιπόν ότι ήταν πολλά τα στοιχεία που είχαν εναντίον του, γιατί το να κάνει διανομή των εθνικών γεών στους ακτήμονες αγωνιστές, αυτό τον έβαζε μπροστά και στους ηθήνοντες, τους Έλληνες, τους μεγάλους γεωκτήμονες, αλλά και στις ξένες δυνάμεις, διότι για το μεγάλο δάνειο των 2 εκατομμυρίων λιρών είχαν βάλει υποθήκη τις εθνικές γεές. Όπως νομίζω κάτι ανάλογο νομίζω ότι έχουμε και σήμερα, έτσι, με τις εγγύσεις.
Δυστυχώς, ναι, συνεχίζει η ιστορία, επιστρέφει.
Συνεχίζει η ιστορία, βλέπετε, είναι καταπληκτικό.
Πριν κλείσουμε, κυρία Γρηγοράκο, θέλουμε να σας ευχαριστήσουμε για τη μεγάλη προσφορά που κάνετε κι εσείς, που βοηθάτε να περάσει το μήνυμα του αημνήστου Δημήτρη Κοκκινάκη, για να μάθουμε κι εμείς.
Να γνωρίζουμε καλύτερα την ιστορία μας.
Είναι σπουδαίο πράγμα και για δύο αιώνες έχουμε άλλη αντίποση και τώρα επιτέλους η αλήθεια βγαίνει. Να είστε καλά, σας ευχαριστούμε.
Να είστε καλά, καλή συνέχεια της εκπομπής και ευχαριστούμε για όλα όσα κάνετε για την ιστορία μας.
Χαρά μας και μεγάλη μας υπερηφάνεια. Γεια σας. Να είστε
γεια
καλά.
Σας.
Καλό βράδυ.
Χαρά μου και τιμή μου. Γεια σας.
Γεια σας. So you have been listening to the two interviews that just took place from Greece. One is the widow of the late Kokkinakis, and as well as Professor Grigorakos, who we just heard. For those of you who may not have understood, there is a verification pretty much of everything we've said here on the show tonight. And in addition to that, we've heard that there was a lot of pressure put on the late researcher, and the archives in England still sit in a protected place, justified as classified information. Of course, the release of that information would pretty much bring to an end what had happened on that day in 1831. So we've come to the end of the show. Esmeralda, you've done it again. Thank you for bringing this opportunity
to
us.
Thank you very, very
and,
much,
Michael. I'm going to have to go home and think about this one. This is a really hot topic here tonight. And a big thank you to you.
And thank you.
And we look forward to having you again here on this special edition of Musical Masterworks. You have been listening to your host, Mike Stratis. A big thank you to our engineer, Stylianos Nicolaou. Thanks to him. And if you have any questions, please feel free to call at 718-204-8900. I'll be back in 2 weeks. Until then, have a wonderful night.